start talking right now. California is one step closer to becoming the first state in the nation to legalize safe houses where addicts could use illegal drugs under medical supervision. Now, the bill has passed the assembly and goes to a state Senate committee on health today. At these supervised injection sites, users would be allowed to shoot themselves with drugs like heroin and smoke hard drugs. Drug groups are promoting it as a life-saving approach to the opioid overdose problem. Now, the closest thing to it is an injection site in Vancouver, Canada. Now, that facility claims it prevented more than 6,000 overdoses in 13 years and placed more than 4,500 people into treatment. Still, critics call it a deadly idea. So, Michelle, let's start with you. What do you think about it?
Oh, I don't like it. I don't like it at all. I understand the concept. I get the point. But I feel like at that situation, you're enabling the addict. And if there was a rehabilitation program or kind of a situation where, okay, you can do this and then they eventually wean you off, how do you recover? How do you get over your addiction? So I understand the whole idea of, okay, they're going to do it anyway, maybe, so let's monitor it. But it's enabling them. How about try to find a solution where there's a rehab program? It just seems like you're playing with fire. I don't really like it at all.
It could open some doors.
Yeah.
Kevin, what do you think?
I disagree with Michelle. I think this is a huge problem in this country, right? And we don't have a solution for it yet. So we need to try different ways to, hey, maybe this does work. We don't know yet until we try it. It reminds me a little bit of like the cool parents in high school who's like, I'm going to let my kids drink at the house because they're going to do it anyway.
So let's have them drink at our house.
I'm going to be under, you know, have them under my supervision while they do it. But still, we need to try something.
Kind of like Michelle here, I don't like the idea. Unless there's a definite plan of action to get them into that counseling. Because if you're just going, yeah, come on out, do all your hard drugs, yeah, we'll be a safe place to do all that stuff. Well, how is that helping anything? I mean, there needs to be an actual step program. Yeah, you're coming here and you may be safe, but we're also going to bombard you with ways to try to help get you better.
You think there's a chance it could, if it passes in California, expand to other states?
If it goes well, as you mentioned earlier, in Canada, and it goes well there, people would be hard-pressed not to look at it because of, as you mentioned, the problem that is growing drastically nationwide at this time.
Follow suit.
Interesting. Okay.
Something to watch. If your child is under the age of 7, he or she is not allowed inside this North Dakota store. The owner of Plato's Closet in Fargo says the ban against children is due to previous problems in the store, problems involving kids that they say you wouldn't believe. The owner says she's even had to talk to police about those situations. The legal opinion on this is yes, businesses can ban kids under a certain age because children are not a protected class of people. Even so, some parents say this is ridiculous. Kevin?
I'm all love this idea. we already have like restaurants and stuff you need to be 21 and up to go to, so why not have stores? And we can put this in the movie theaters. I think we need this in movie theaters. We need this with certain airplanes, like certain flights where
He's
nobody
just
under the age
started.
In case it's not like clear, this. Kevin does not have children.
Well, they couldn't have like a shopping cart basket or something like that. Your kid has to stay in the basket if you're going to be shopping if they're under 7. And I'd be very curious to find
out. Wait a minute.
They're not going to stay in the basket.
Well, then they don't get to go in the store. I mean, I was trying to give them an out right there.
So you're saying leave them out.
I'm trying to figure out what did the 7-year-old or under kids do that is so bad that got them banned from the store to begin with.
I want to know how you get rowdy in a Plato's Closet. It's like ripping clothes down.
I'm going to go put this on over here, and I'm going to go try this.
I want to know. I think it's ridiculous, but I'm also not the store owner, so I'm not going to tell anybody how to run their business. So if you don't want kids up in there, that's fine. That's your choice. But I really want to. I'm clearly missing some parties and late night sessions at Plato's Closet. So.
All right. Now this next story will probably have you scratching your head. A barbershop in Oklahoma City is stirring up controversy after a black barber agreed to cut a Confederate flag design in a white man's hair over the weekend. Now, of course, many people still see that flag as a symbol of racism and hate and are angry that the shop allowed the haircut. But the owner says the barbershop is the last place left where you can talk about religion. You can talk about politics, sports, girls, guys, and keep it all fun, he says. He says everyone is entitled to their opinion, but that those opinions don't pay his bills. Kevin.
Me first. Is there a chance he was just getting the Mississippi State flag on his head and they ran out of room? That's my question.
I I don't know. I saw that.
He did want a different flag, but there wasn't room, so that's why they settled on the Confederate. But no, it was intentional.
What, he was going for like the Nazi flag.
It's called a compromise.
Yeah,
compromise.
And I think it all has to do also with the money as well. This gentleman said, hey, this is my store. I'm paying the bills. I'll do whatever I want at this particular location. So, and there's a unique, I guess, relationship between the person getting their hair done or did and the person doing it. I mean, there's a relationship there, the conversation, as you mentioned, that included politics, included religion, and maybe that sparked a great conversation between the two of them. I don't know.
Yeah, at the end of the day, he's a paying customer, and if he wants to, as the owner or the barber or whoever, accept that payment and do that, his choice. But you also have the choice to not go to that shop if you don't like it. Right. So,
or that barber could have said no.
Yeah.
Maybe the critics ought to say to the barber, here, I'll give you the money so that you don't do it. Because, come on, if you're getting up in the guy's business.
I wouldn't go to that shop. So, but again, I can't tell you how to run your business. If you want to do it, go for it.
All right, we'll keep it moving.
All right, there is a new tequila on the market, and it sells, no, wait, hang on a second, $30,000 per bottle.
How much?
30 foul. Okay. Well, that's some kind of tequila. Okay, Clase Azul, I'm guessing at the pronunciation, is part of a surge in luxury tequilas. The tequila comes in hand-sculpted, hand-painted ceramic decanters. Mm. Some have amber. AC, some have 24-karat gold studding on the
right
bottle.
Down my alley.
There you
yeah.
go. The founder of the company says his tequila is made for savoring, not for making cocktails or downing as a shot. U.S. sales of high-end and what's called super premium tequila have surged by 67% in the past decade, so somebody's buying it. Michelle? Any way on this earth you would pay $30,000 for a bottle of anything?
If you are paying $30,000 for tequila, you have way too much money.
And not enough sense,
probably a whole bunch of problems. Now, I can't judge you if you've got that money and that's how you want to spend your money. Look at all these, George Clooney, his own business, Justin Timberlake, 901 Tequila. Mm-hmm. So there is that market for sure with people having money and loving tequila. So if you can buy it, I'm not going to judge you for it, but $30,000 for tequila, I think even if I were rich, I'd put my $30,000 elsewhere than tequila.
There are starving children.
Kevin, you really are thinking about this very deeply here.
Well, actually, I brought a bottle for us to sample.
I accidentally kicked that over earlier.
No! Sorry.
That trivia business is doing well.
It's doing extremely well, isn't it?
It's pretty absurd, yeah, $30,000. Yeah. Like you said, if you have that type of money, you can do whatever you want, whether you can get your whatever haircut you want, you can do whatever you want, but I would not buy it.
Sounds like a status type symbol. It's kind of like if you're up in New York and you want to buy that $1,000 burger or something like
that.
I would get that.
It's almost like I just want to show you how rich I am by being able to do this. But I don't drink, but it would be interesting to find out whether or not it's actually worth that amount of money.
I wonder how much a sample would be.
I don't even know how you can make tequila taste that different. I don't know.
And
pretty expensive margarita.
Finally, this morning, there's a new wedding trend that takes place before the ceremony. More couples are booking what's called an early moon, a chance to take a break before taking your vows. Pippa Middleton, one of the trend-setting celebrities doing just this. Wedding planners say it's a chance to get away from the stress of planning the big day. So seriously, is it that hard these days to plan a wedding, Michelle? You're getting married pretty soon.
I knew you were going to do that.
I got to put the focus back on you.
If he didn't, we were going to, so just go ahead.
I'm getting married in like a month, and I got to tell you, I need one of these. I need it so bad. There is a difference between this and a vacation. You lose your way when you're planning it. I don't know what happens, but it's kind of this thing where it overtakes you. The stress kicks in. You forget that it's about the two of you getting married and the love.
Well, the industry tells you you need this,
We have talked so much about if we can just do things over, we would go on a little early vacation, which would literally be this, and just take a break and go, you know what, we're just going to get married here. If you guys want to fly in and join us, do it. So I totally get this. Like, it gets to you.
What if I just give you that $30,000 bottle of tequila instead of the break?
I would say I'd sell it and take back every poor decision I've made in the past year. Please give it to me.
Please. Okay.
Early moon. I thought an early moon was the first moon after daylight savings time.
I thought it was a weather-related story for a second there, but it's not. Early moon.
Early moon.
Yeah. It was just a vacation.
Good luck.
All right.
Good luck.
You
said good luck.
You kept it interesting.
She needs the tequila.